Before we get into today's video, a massive shout out to Discord user Lun4, who won the most recent artist challenge on the Eckhart's Ladder Discord. I want to also apologize for being so late in announcing and celebrating the winner, but as you can see, they made an awesome animation which seemed to depict Thrawn rendezvousing his forces within the Empire of the Hand, perhaps before the Thrawn campaign. So I'll link to that video in the Eckhart's Ladder Discord down in the description. Again, really great job. Hey guys, this is Eckhart Slaughter. Hello and welcome to another video. Today we'll be talking about the Nadiri Starhawk, which is unique and one of the only, if not the only, new capital ships in the Star Wars canon, which has originated in a book. The Starhawk was a monstrous vessel. At my estimation, it's over 2 kilometers long and is obviously very well armored and armed. Starhawks most notably participated at the Battle of Jakku, where a single one ripped a super star destroyer down to Jakku's surface, and really their fate after that point is sort of unknown, although I would guess the New Republic did not have too many of them due to their de-escalation of the war and the associated demilitarization. So the unique thing about Starhawks is that they're actually created out of disassembled Imperial ships and specifically star destroyers. It's unclear how many disassembled constituent star destroyers were needed for a single Starhawk, but if we look at the battlecruiser, we can see that it uses at least 4 ISD-style shield bulbs, and generally because of its size, we can guess that there's at least 2 needed, perhaps even more. There's a lot functionally we could discuss about the Starhawk in terms of its design, and whether it's smart to focus all of that technology into a tractor beam of all things, but what I really want to discuss in this video is whether even having something like the Starhawk makes any sense whatsoever. One of the main issues I've had with new Star Wars canon is how sort of truncated the entire post-Endor conflict with the Empire feels, and to me the Starhawk is fairly emblematic of this greater issue. Let's talk about Star Wars Legends first, because I think comparatively it has a much better handling of the years after the Battle of Endor. The main loss the Empire suffered at Endor was that of leadership and in quality officers. Many of the best ships in the Empire were at the battle. Of course, Palpatine and Vader died, many important officers would have died, the Death Star 2 was destroyed, and the defending fleet also took quite a beating. But still, the Empire vastly outweighed the New Republic when it came to pure military strength. For the next, I'd say, 15 years, that means that the New Republic is technically less powerful than the combined remnants of the Empire in the galaxy, but because the Empire is so fractured, and the New Republic has fairly consistent and competent leadership, they're able to successfully govern and fight a series of ongoing wars. Now, things have changed in Star Wars canon that make this comparison not wholly fair. For example, a lot of the Empire just sort of pieced out into the unknown regions. We have Operation Cinder and many leaving the Empire because of the post-Endor actions that the Empire took. But still, if I were writing the Star Wars Aftermath trilogy, which really sets up a lot of this era, I would have the New Republic as a much smaller faction, basically fighting against the Chaos. But what I would have done is not really relevant. Anyway, moving back to Legends, one of the main sources of New Republic capital ships after the Battle of Endor was actually captured Imperial Star Destroyers. Star Destroyers were a very powerful capital ship, but despite that, were also very widespread throughout the galaxy. The Rebels managed to capture some even at the Battle of Endor, and in subsequent years, whether through combat, defection, or whatever else, new Star Destroyers were being added to the New Republic fleet, basically on an ongoing basis. And I mean, this is just because the Empire in its peak was so militarized compared to basically any other faction in Star Wars history. And even onto the years of the Yuuzhan Vong invasion and beyond, Star Destroyers were a very prominent part of the New Republic and later Galactic Alliance navies. I mean, the first New Republic capital ship to engage the Yuuzhan Vong in battle, at least formally, was a Star Destroyer. Princess Leia, of all people, took up a Star Destroyer as her flagship. Solo Command, the New Republic task force which hunted down Warlord Zinj, had at least three ISDs within it, and just generally Star Destroyers played a very important role in many New Republic fleets. And what's more, the good guys actually would iterate on the design somewhat, making even more advanced ISDs, including ones with internalized interdiction generators like the Mon Mothma, or with better weapons and other features like the Anakin Solo. So that's how Legends did it. Moving to canon, instead of just using the captured ISDs, it seems like the Rebels instead chose to disassemble them and make them into Starhawks. Does this make any sense, really? Well, there are certainly a few things that bring that into question. First of all, the New Republic already had several Starhawks ready to go by the Battle of Jakku, and that was less than a year after the Battle of Endor. Would the New Republic really have had time to not only design a completely new cutting-edge capital ship, but also disassemble ships such that they could build one? Well, perhaps, but it does seem like, given the requirements of war and the fact that the New Republic had a much smaller military, that they just pushed the ISDs into service, and there is no indication that these Star Destroyers were in any way destroyed or damaged. But personally, I think that would have been a good explanation for why they were not just put on the front lines. I just don't think it really makes sense for the Republic to take apart two or three Imperial Star Destroyers to make this more powerful ship, especially when there has to be some sort of waste associated with this process. And I'm not talking just time, but also materials. There's also the fact that Imperial Star Destroyers were generally the strongest ships in most Imperial fleets, with some exceptions, so do you really need something which is that much more powerful? And then there's the fact that when you take three ships and turn them into one, you're naturally losing some flexibility. You can't cut a Starhawk in half and send one on a defensive mission somewhere and send the other out to attack Jakku. That being said, the Starhawk does have a few arguments for it as well. The Imperial Star Destroyer was a very crew-intensive capital ship. Maybe that's brought way down with something like the Starhawk. Although I will say, we learn in the Alphabet Squadron book that there are a lot of Imperial defectors being sent to the front line. Although it might be kind of perverse, it makes a lot of sense to put them in a capital ship that they're already familiar with, and I don't think the New Republic was really dealing with, between volunteers and ex-Imperials, a crew shortage, which would necessitate getting rid of essentially free ships. However, I do think the efficiency is an attractive explanation. Another one would be that the galaxy by this point associates Star Destroyers as much as any Imperial technology with fear and oppression. Should the New Republic in its first months really be using a symbol of terror to fight a war? I don't know, but personally I do think it's somewhat inspiring actually to see these weapons of destruction turned against the faction which has abused the galaxy for two decades. I think it's a nice bit of poetic justice. But even if that's not the case, I think when you're still actively fighting a war against the Empire, one that is still very much up in the air, I don't think you have the luxury of worrying about optics. I think that's a problem for when you've properly started governing. Yeah, maybe in peacetime you don't want Star Destroyers patrolling space. I mean, I would, because they're awesome, but when you're still the scrappy Rebel Alliance, essentially, you use whatever you've got. The final thing I'll say is that a new capital ship offers the ability to mount the newest high-tech technology, and that's exactly what they did with the tractor beam emitter, for example. And in Aftermath, they talk about how high-tech the interior of the Starhawk is and whatnot. So I do think there's honest debate to be had on both sides of the issue. I'm not going to come down and say that the Starhawk is, all in all, a stupid capital ship, but I think it would have made a lot more sense if they had seen the Starhawks roll out maybe 5 years or so after the Battle of Endor, or even after the Battle of Jakku. The main issue I have, and this is what I said earlier, is that time is far too truncated. It's not believable that the Empire would see ship losses as extreme as they did in just the few months after the Battle of Endor. Nor, in my opinion, is it believable that the New Republic would be able or would have the resources to essentially throw away good ships for perhaps months at shipyards to make this new super capital ship. I will say that the Starhawk is cool, so I'm willing to look past most of this. I also just really do like the idea, though, of the New Republic using Star Destroyers, so I hope we learn more about that in future material. That was one thing that I was hoping to see in Alphabet Squadron. I thought it would have been cool if Hera was in a Star Destroyer instead of an Acclimator, which I also do like, but a Star Destroyer would have been more appropriate, in my opinion. But these have just been my opinions. Am I being too nitpicky? Am I being too critical of the timeline restrictions? Do you like the idea of the New Republic using old Imperial ships, and specifically the Star Destroyer, or is the symbolism issue just too much? And would the galaxy maybe revolt against another faction, once again using these weapons of war? Let me know all of that and more down in the comments. If you have any future video ideas you'd like me to see make on this channel, please let me know that as well down in the comments. But until next time, guys, have a good one. May the Force be with you.